Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Under the Radar by Annette Dashofy, narrated by Romy Nordlinger. 1. Did it seem odd to you? Zoe Chambers asked her paramedic partner, Earl Coulter, as the pair stepped out of the Walden's Cafe. The way Tony shoot us out? Earl adjusted his grip on the plastic bags holding his half of the ambulance crew's lunch order.
I figured he was hungry.
Zoe wasn't buying the simple explanation. There was something more. The cold breeze of early November blew a mist of rain into her face. Hands full with bags containing the rest of the takeout order, she tipped her head so the bill of her ball cap shielded her eyes. The leaden gray sky had been dumping rain on them all morning and most of the previous week. At first, she thought their crew chief, Tony DeLuca, had merely hustled them out on the lunch run due to the lull and the heavier precipitation. But she'd known him too long. He wasn't hungry. He was worried. Her concerns amped up when she and Earl rounded the corner at the top of the hill. Below them, a crowd gathered on the sidewalk in front of their ambulance garage. Earl saw it, too.
What's going on?
Zoe scanned the throng. Still too far away to make out expressions, she didn't sense upset or fear radiating from the small mob. She'd worked on Monongahela County's EMS long enough to recognize the emotions surrounding an accident or crime scene and saw none of that. Instead, they appeared curious, jostling for a better view into the large front window. Earl shifted his takeout bags to one hand, dug out his phone, and thumbed the screen. Who are you texting?
Tony. I want to know what we're walking into.
Zoe picked up her pace. We'll find out soon enough. The industrial-sized garage door in front of the first bay rumbled open as they approached, and a man Zoe had become all too familiar with led a small entourage out onto the sidewalk. Charles Davis, she muttered, more to herself than to Earl.
Oh, goody. How did we manage to become a campaign stop?
Dr. Charles Davis, forensic pathologist and candidate for the county coroner's position, popped open a black umbrella against the drizzle. He lifted his face and spotted them.
Aw,
his voice carried, rising over the spatter of rain on Zoe's ball cap and jacket.
Miss Chambers, I was hoping to run into you.
She sensed every eye in the crowd turn in her direction. Even Earl looked at her. Davis was determined to put the current coroner out of a job, which would subsequently eliminate her part-time gig as deputy coroner. She doubted the candidate was here to offer her a position on his staff, especially since most of the re-elect Franklin Marshall signs dotting Phillipsburg's and Vance Township's roadsides were her doing. Battling her desire to veer from her path and go anywhere but the garage, she braced for the confrontation and closed the distance between them. Earl kept with her, moving like one of the Steelers' offensive linemen. Zoe stopped in front of Davis. "You came here just to see me?" she asked, knowing it wasn't true.
Of course not, he sniffed. I've come to talk to the good people of Phillipsburg, including the brave first responders of the county EMS. I'll be working closely with everyone here in the near future. I thought I should get to know them.
She didn't miss his use of them rather than you. Maybe he thought he had the power to fire her from this job, too. Tony, who hadn't returned Earl's text, appeared through the crowd and took her takeout bags from her. Was he afraid she'd drop the guy's lunch? Or was he hungry and expected this conversation to take a while? She caught and read his pained expression.
You knew he was coming, she said sotto voce. His campaign manager called earlier and said he'd be here at noon.
Tony matched her low tone.
I hoped he'd be in and out before you guys got back.
He and the crew's lunch headed for the safety of the EMS office. Davis kept his cold eyes and saccharine smile directed at Zoe.
I did want to speak to you too, Ms. Chambers. In case you held out any delusions of continuing to work for my office once I'm elected, I thought it only fair to inform you your services will not be needed.
She hoped her poker face honed through many Saturday night card games with her local friends and colleagues held firm. Are you using a magic eight ball to predict the future these days? His smile wavered closer to a snarl, but he recovered.
I don't need a magic eight ball, Ms. Chambers. I have pulls that place me solidly in the lead, as it should be.
He aimed his voice over his shoulder to the voting public behind him.
Monongahela County's residents are tired of living in the Dark Ages, where truth and justice are laid in the hands of butchers and funeral directors. Men,
he raised an eyebrow,
and women who aren't qualified to dissect a frog, but are given the responsibility of determining how crime and accident victims died. How many killers have gone free because these inept amateurs declared a death to be from natural causes when, in fact, murder was involved? How many incompetent medical doctors have avoided legal actions because nothing deemed suspicious was detected during autopsy?
Davis used the hand not gripping the umbrella to make air quotes around autopsy. The phone inside the garage rang, but Davis didn't bat an eye. Had they not been surrounded by a couple dozen townspeople, plus a handful of local reporters, Zoe wouldn't have graced the man with a reply. He was well aware of how the coroner's office worked. The public, however, appeared to be buying his lies. As I'm sure you're aware, Coroner Franklin Marshall contracts with a licensed forensic pathologist to perform all autopsies. And I think even you have to agree that Dr. Abercrombie is more than qualified. Davis beamed triumphantly.
Thank you for bringing that up. Yes, in its current sad state, the coroner's office must pay to have qualified personnel perform autopsies. That's taxpayers' money going toward an unnecessary expense, one that will be eliminated once I'm elected.
Zoe cringed. She'd taken the bait and set Davis up for one of his key campaign promises.
Zoe, Tony shouted from the office doorway. Earl?
The crew chief flapped a slip of paper.
You're up.
He faced the crowd.
Please clear the front of the station so we don't run over anyone.
She and Earl were not the team who was supposed to take the next run. Tony was rearranging the order to get her away from Davis and his followers. She owed her crew chief a big favor, although the swap meant she would miss lunch. Earl led the way, herding the crowd back as he strode toward Medic 2. Zoe followed in his wake without another glance at the coroner candidate or at the faces of his audience. Earl shoved his takeout bags at Tony and headed for the driver's door. The crew chief handed the paper to Zoe and caught her arm as she passed, pulling her close enough to whisper in her ear.
The caller was Horace Pavelka. He claims he shot and killed a man. Police are en route.
Zoe met Tony's gaze. He'd refrained from mentioning a shooting in front of the media and Davis to save her and Earl from being followed to the scene. But it was the caller's name that explained why Tony told Zoe instead of Earl. She gave her crew chief a quick nod of appreciation, climbed into the passenger seat, and told Earl, Langstown. Earl whooped the siren as a woman with a camera stepped in front of the ambulance to snap a photo. She scuttled backward, tripped, but regained her balance. As the woman lowered her camera, Zoe caught a glimpse of her face. Is that? The woman turned away before Zoe could be sure. Earl wheeled Medic 2 left onto Main Street and hit the gas.
You gonna tell me what this call is, or are you saving it for a surprise?
Zoe erased the mental image of a woman she hadn't seen in almost a year, and probably hadn't seen a moment ago either. Horace Pavelka claims he shot and killed someone.
Horace who?
Zoe repeated the last name. We were friends in high school.
Never heard of him.
I'm not surprised. He was very quiet, reserved, shy. Still is. Earl glanced her way.
Still? You've seen him recently?
He works at Brunswick Bakery. I've stopped in a couple of times about... She let the thought trail off. The stress of rushing into an emergency situation involving a shooting couldn't compete with the stress of planning the happiest day of her life.
About your wedding cake? Earl asked with a grin.
Yeah. She picked up the mic. Control, this is Medic 2. Show us en route. Earl grew quiet, and the wail of the siren filled the silence. As they approached the turn from Phillipsburg's main street onto the road to take them up Langstown Hill, Earl asked,
Your shy wedding cake baker friend shot someone?
So he says. In theory, Vance Township Police Chief Pete Adams had Saturdays off. In reality, neither the calendar nor the weather kept him from responding to a homicide call in his jurisdiction. Langstown was one of the many former coal mining towns dotting Vance Township and southwestern Pennsylvania. It had fared better than most. When the coal petered out and the mines shut down, a steel production company took over and operated until a few decades ago. While the old mill still limped along, employing a skeleton crew, the once thriving town's nicer homes suffered the same neglect as the cookie-cutter company houses. Pete tugged on his ball cap, stepped out into the cold November drizzle, and took in the scene. A tarp covered a human-shaped mound at the end of a narrow driveway, a baseball bat a few feet away. Pete's weekend officer, Nate Williamson, held a shotgun, not his department issue, and loomed over an older model red Chevy Malibu coupe, its headlights and passenger side window shattered. The windshield showed evidence of blunt force trauma, although it remained intact. A man with thinning red hair perched on the edge of the driver's seat, hugging his left elbow close to his body. Sirens keened in the distance. Pete approached his officer.
What have we got? Nate tipped his head at the man in the car. This is Horace Pavelka. He lives here.
Nate glanced over the car's hood at the body.
The deceased is Dennis Culp. Shotgun blast to the center of the chest.
Nate hefted the 12-gauge shotgun, an inexpensive tactical pump with an 18.5-inch barrel, the kind used for protection, not hunting.
Horace admits to discharging the weapon and willingly surrendered it to me.
The man in the car raised his round, tear-streaked face.
I was afraid he was gonna kill me.
Pete knew Culp. Tough guy, or so he fancied himself. Opinionated and convinced that his take on any topic was the only one that mattered. But any time Pete had gone toe-to-toe with the man, Culp had backed down. A cluster of onlookers huddled on the sidewalk several houses away, some with their phones out taking photos. Neighbors gathered on the porches of the surrounding homes. Pete noticed a woman watching them from the house next door, an address he used to be well acquainted with. He met her emotionless gaze, expecting she'd turn away or lower her face. She did neither. A pair of Pennsylvania State Police SUVs made the turn onto the street and cut their sirens, although more filled the air. Pete looked at Nate.
Did you call for EMS?
Yep.
He tipped his head toward Pavelka. He needs his arm looked at. Meeting Pete's gaze, Nate's lips curled with a hint of grin.
Recoil. The grin vanished. And I call the coroner. Tag and secure the weapon, then rope off the area and handle crowd control.
Pete gestured toward the amateur paparazzo.
I want any pictures or videos they've shot. And question the neighbors. Anyone who saw what happened.
He looked at the neighbor woman still standing on her porch, watching.
Except her. I'll talk to Mrs. Gates. On it, Chief.
As Nate strode away, Pete turned to the man in the car.
Mind if I ask you some questions?
Pavelka glanced after Nate.
I already told him what happened.
I know you did.
Pete gave him a sympathetic smile.
Unfortunately, you'll have to repeat your story a few more times before we wrap this up.
Pavelka cradled his left arm and rocked like a mother soothing her child.
Okay.
Pete opened his notebook.
Tell me what happened. I was coming home from work.
Where's that?
Brunswick Bakery.
I saw Dennis and his buddies standing on the sidewalk in front of my house, waiting on me.
How did you know they were waiting on you and not just hanging out? Because it's not the first time.
A marked Monongahela County police cruiser rounded the turn at the end of the block and rolled toward them.
Not the first time? Pete echoed. They've been harassing me for months.
Who are they?
Dennis, Grant, and Stanley Jennings. And Reese Perkins.
Pete jotted down the names. Along with Culp, he'd encountered the Jennings brothers all too often. Drunk and disorderlies by the dozens. A handful of simple assaults. But Reese Perkins? Never heard of him.
All four of them were standing there when I drove up, blocking my driveway so I couldn't get in. Dennis had the bat, was swinging it around and leering, calling me names, yelling I should get out of my car.
Did you?
Pavelka's eyes widened.
No, I was scared, terrified, for my life, you know?
A black, unmarked sedan with red and blue lights embedded in the grill turned onto the street. An ambulance followed.
What did you do? Pete asked.
I tried to drive through them, tried to get into my driveway. I hoped they'd get out of my way, but Dennis wouldn't move. He started bashing on my car, the hood, the headlights, the windshield.
Pete surveyed the interior of the car. Glass pebbles glittered on the passenger seat.
And the window?
Yeah.
Then what?
Horace stared at his knees.
I shot him. Through the broken window.
What did the others do?
They ran.
Smart move. You carry a shotgun in your car?
The soft splat of footsteps approaching on the rain-soaked road drew Pete's attention. Zoe and Earl had parked their rig in the middle of the street and lugged a pair of medical bags and portable defibrillator with them. County Detective Wayne Baronic trailed behind. Pete met Zoe's gorgeous baby blues and answered her unspoken question by nodding toward the tarp-covered mound. To Earl, he said,
"This gentleman seems to have injured his arm."
Instead of diverting to the deceased's body as Pete expected, Zoe paused, looking at Pavelka. "Horace?" she said.
"Zoe?"
he replied, his voice quivering, pleading. She looked to Pete, to the body, and back to the man in the car. "I'll talk to you in a bit," she said. "Okay?"
"Okay."
She crossed in front of the car to deal with the body. Pete didn't have to watch. He knew she'd begin in paramedic mode, even though the man was clearly beyond help. Once she confirmed the fact, she'd note the official time of death and slip into deputy coroner mode, photographing and processing the body. Earl set his jump kit on the hood of the car and removed a blood pressure cuff and stethoscope. Baronic, attired in a long dark raincoat and fedora, acknowledged Pete with a nod and followed Zoe. While Earl took Pavelka's vitals, Pete resumed his questions.
"The shotgun. Why did you have it in your car?"
The man's voice was little more than a whisper.
"Protection from those men, Dennis and his gang."
"You mentioned they'd been harassing you. How?"
He looked up at Pete, his eyes brimming.
"Following me around stores and town, crowding me, pushing me. Dennis tripped me outside the bargain store in Phillipsburg 2 weeks ago."
Pavelka held open his palms, revealing healing abrasions.
"I was scraped up real good. They laughed, said I was a clumsy oaf, called me all sorts of names."
He winced as Earl palpated the elbow he'd been shielding.
"I had a dog. I found her..."
His voice broke.
"Dead. Poisoned. I know it was them. I can't prove it, but I know it was them. Last week they threw a rock through my kitchen window. Again, I can't prove anything, but I know."
Pete gazed at the surrounding houses. Horace Pavelka's home was plain but neat. Jen Gates no longer watched him. Dead hanging baskets decorated her now vacant front porch. Pete scanned the small crowd behind the yellow tape Nate had strung. She wasn't with them. The state troopers and county officers worked the locals, asking questions. Someone on this street had seen what transpired. If no one else, Jan Gates most assuredly had.
"Chief," Earl said, "do you mind if I take him over to the ambulance to immobilize his arm?"
Pete held up a finger. "One minute."
"Mr. Pavelka, I have to ask, if these men have been intimidating you for months, as you say, why haven't you reported them to me?"
He slouched forward.
"It was their word against mine."
Pete opened his mouth to tell him he should have gotten the threats on record. Pavelka cut him off.
"And because they said they'd kill me if I said anything."
2. One look at the body beneath the tarp told Zoe that Dennis Culp was dead. The shotgun blast at close range, center mass, left a hole the size of her fist in his chest. His lifeless eyes stared at the sky, a look of surprise frozen on his face. She wiggled her hands into a pair of nitrile gloves, clipped a blood ox meter to his finger, and checked his pupils for the non-existent reaction. She spread open his unzipped jacket, slipped her scissors from her pocket, and cut the front of his sweatshirt, allowing her to attach the EKG leads. The flatline on the monitor officially confirmed what she already knew. She looked at her watch and noted TOD, 12:57. What the hell had happened? Sweet, soft-spoken Horace Pavelka had taken a life?
"Can I give you a hand?"
She shook her head, clearing it of personal assumptions, and looked up at Wayne Baronic, who waited patiently for her to shift from lifesaver to death investigator. "In a minute. I need to get some photos first."
"All right. I'll check on our witnesses and be right back."
By the time she'd put away the defibrillator and taken photos of the body as she'd found it, wider angle shots showing the man's position on the sidewalk and closer shots to catch all the details, Wayne returned.
"What do you need me to do?" he asked.
"Help me roll him."
"You do know it was a shotgun, right? There isn't going to be an exit wound."
She gave him her best dull look. "I still have to roll him and photograph what is or isn't under the body."
Wayne winked at her. "Oh.
You're not funny."
"Pete tells me the same thing."
Nate Williamson wandered over as Zoe held the victim's head and Wayne knelt next to the body, reached across, and log-rolled the man toward him. Wayne had been right. No exit wound. Nothing under the body, either. "Hey," Zoe said to Nate, "grab my camera and take some pictures for me." Unlike the county detective with his warped sense of humor, Nate remained stoic as he accomplished the requested task. Once they'd returned the victim to his back and Zoe gingerly settled his head on the pavement, she stood and retrieved the notebook she'd been using to record her findings. "What can you guys tell me about the weapon used?"
"H&R tactical shotgun," Nate said. 12-gauge.
"Ammo?"
"Buckshot."
Zoe added the information to her notes. She'd been working with the coroner's office long enough to know about Franklin Marshall's zest for detailed reports. Wayne turned to Nate.
"My county guys have been talking with some of the neighbors. No one saw what happened, only the aftermath. What about you?"
"The neighbor over there."
Nate lifted his chin toward the house to the left of Horace's place.
"Said he heard raised voices and got up to look, but heard the gunshot before he made it to the window." "What about the neighbor on the other side?"
"Chief said to leave her to him. Got the impression he knows her."
Pete's voice confirmed Nate's suspicion.
"I do."
Zoe spun to find Pete standing behind her. "Is that a good thing or a bad thing?" she asked.
You knowing the neighbor lady, I mean. He shrugged.
Depends on what she tells me.
He fixed his icy gaze on Nate.
Have you knocked on all the other neighbors' doors already?
He slumped.
Not yet, sir.
Zoe concealed a grin. Nate Williamson towered over all of them and may or may not have been a professional football player, depending on whether you believed the rumors. But Pete had the commanding presence to wilt even the big guy.
He was helping me process the body, she said.
Nate shot a grateful glance her way.
Fine.
Pete jabbed a thumb toward the other side of the street.
Get back to work.
He eyed Wayne.
You too. May I remind you, you aren't my commanding officer?
Pete kept him locked in that cold, hard stare. Wayne growled in annoyance.
But I guess I should check on my men.
Through the gloves, Zoe fingered the diamond ring on her left hand. If they hadn't been standing over a dead body, she'd have nudged Pete's shoulder with her own, an innocent, crowd-safe gesture of affection they'd developed.
Do you know this guy? He asked.
She looked down at the man at her feet, and then over at the ambulance's open rear doors, where Earl was placing a sling on Horace's arm.
Which guy are you talking about?
I already gathered, you know, the shooter. What about the victim?
She brought her gaze back to the body in front of her.
I haven't seen him in years, but I know who he is.
Dennis Culp was a bully, but she wasn't going to offer her opinion as part of a homicide investigation.
How well do you know the shooter?
She pictured Horace's frightened face, his eyes wide and beseeching. His red hair tinged with gray had thinned, and lines creased his still babyish face. But the expression hadn't changed much in 2 decades.
We graduated high school together.
That's all?
We were friends then. He's a baker now at Brunswick Bakery. A good one, too.
She paused before continuing.
I've stopped in a couple of times to talk to him recently.
She paused again.
About doing our wedding cake.
Oh.
Pete sounded surprised. His opened mouth hinted at a rare moment of speechlessness. The arrival of the county coroner's van rescued him from further comment and saved her from having to reveal more of what she knew of Horace's past. She'd get Pete alone and share later. Franklin climbed from the passenger side and strode toward them. He greeted Pete with a nod before squatting next to the body.
Update, he said to Zoe.
Shotgun blast to the chest from close range.
She handed him the notes she'd jotted.
I've taken photographs and done a preliminary exam. No other obvious injuries.
Franklin looked up at Pete.
Did anyone disturb the body prior to Zoe's arrival?
Nope. Nate didn't move him.
He gestured to a group of neighbors and their cell phones.
Just covered him to protect him from the looky-loos.
Good.
Franklin turned to Zoe.
Let's prep him for transport.
Pete knew from the look in her eyes that Zoe had more information about the shooter. He'd get it out of her later. For now, he left her and Marshall with Dennis Culp's body, climbed the next-door neighbor's porch steps. Jan Gates's late husband Everett had been a well-known and much-despised alcoholic who'd raise hell at several of the seedier local bars before going home and beating the crap out of his wife. On average, Pete and his officers would respond to a couple of domestic dispute calls a week at this address. Sometimes she'd let them haul Everett off to jail. Sometimes she'd tell them to leave her alone to handle the drunken bastard. Pete never understood why she refused to leave him or even file a PFA. At the time, she'd claimed she didn't have any kids to protect and insisted she could take care of herself, in spite of a black eye and bloody lip. The frequent calls to this address in Langstown ended a couple years ago when Everett drank himself into a stupor at Rodeo's bar, then failed to negotiate one of the bends on Langstown Hill,
crashing through the guardrails and rolling his pickup down a steep embankment. He might have been saved had the wreck not gone unnoticed until mid-morning the next day. The woman who answered Pete's knock sported an oversized flannel shirt and threadbare sweatpants. Ample gray-peppered hair that hadn't seen a brush for at least a couple of days. And she wore the same dead-eyed expression as the day he delivered her husband's death notice.
"Chief Adams," she said flatly.
"Mrs. Gates, do you mind if I ask you a few questions?"
"As if it matters whether I mind or not."
Stepping back, she gestured him in. She did not, however, offer him a seat.
"Did you see what happened out there today?"
"Hard to miss."
She wiped her nose on the sleeve of her faded flannel shirt.
"That good-for-nothing Dennis Culp got what was coming to him."
Pete pulled out his notebook.
"Tell me what you saw."
"Heard it first. Dennis and his buddies were at it again, hounding poor Horace out there in the street."
"Again? You've seen them torment Horace before?"
"Lots of times. Almost every day lately. They either yell at him when he's inside his house or, like today, try to block him from getting into his driveway. I've seen them throw rocks at him and at his car."
Pete thought about what Horace had told him.
"Did you happen to see them doing anything to his dog?"
The hard, emotionless mask lifted for a moment, revealing either anger or sadness.
"No, I didn't see anything. I know Horace believes they poisoned it. Wouldn't put it past them."
"You keep saying them. Besides Dennis Culp, who else was out there, in the past and today?"
"The same. Always the same bunch. Dennis was the ringleader. But the Jennings boys were just as bad."
"Anyone else?"
"One other guy. Don't know his name.
He ain't from around here. Tall, dark hair."
"Does the name Reese Perkins sound familiar?"
She pressed her lips into an inverted U and shook her head.
"Nope, that his name?"
"According to Horace. Well, he'd know."
Pete looked at the woman. She held his gaze.
"You've witnessed a history of their harassment toward Horace. What else happened today?"
"I heard the yelling again. I went out on my porch to tell those men to leave Horace alone. But they ignored me. Dennis had a bat and was beating the hell out of Horace's car. Next thing I knew, bam, Horace shot him. I don't think Dennis even knew what hit him. Damn shame, too. I'd like to have seen him know exactly why he got what he did. Would have served him right to suffer some."
Pete studied Jan Gates, looking for some sign of embarrassment over what she'd said. There was none.
"What did the other three do when Horace shot Dennis?"
"They ain't fools. They took off before he could unload on them, too."
"Is there anything else you can tell me?"
She shook her head.
"Just that the world's a better place without Dennis Culp in it."
Pete thanked her and pocketed his notebook, making a mental note to never get on Jan Gates's bad side. Back on the street, the coroner's van pulled out with Culp inside. Zoe, Earl, and Horace stood at the rear of the ambulance with Baronic. Horace looked more like a traumatized victim than a criminal, which made the next step all the more difficult.
"The next-door neighbor supports everything you told us," Pete said to Horace.
The quartet looked at Pete, but he met only Baronic's gaze. The detective gave one nod and turned to Horace.
"I'm placing you under arrest for the homicide of Dennis Culp."
Horace appeared resigned to his fate. Zoe, however, stepped between him and Baronic. It was self-defense.
"That's not up to us," Pete told her.
She looked at Horace. "Do you have an attorney?"
"Yeah, I do."
You need to let him call his lawyer, she said to Baronic with a glance at Pete.
I will, the detective replied.
He lowered his voice.
I'm not interested in railroading your friend, but we have to go through the process. You know that.
He needs to have that arm checked out, too.
I'll make sure he gets medical attention.
Zoe caught her lip between her teeth, having run out of arguments. Horace reached toward her with his free hand, but didn't quite touch her.
I'll be okay. I killed a man. I knew what I was doing.
She shushed him. You have the right to remain silent. Use it.
He shook his head. I'm not hiding from what I did.
To Baronic, he said,
I'm ready to go.
Pete, Zoe, and Earl watched them walk to the unmarked sedan. Once the car had pulled away, Earl placed a hand on Zoe's shoulder.
We need to get back in service.
She exhaled, her shoulders sagging.
Hey, Pete said to her before she could head to the front of the ambulance. We need to talk. About Horace.
There had been times in the past when Zoe had been secretive about her friends and misguided efforts to protect them. This time she met his gaze, her baby blues clear, her jaw set. Yes, we do. Can you come by the ambulance garage later?
You bet.
Nate approached him as the ambulance pulled away.
We've finished talking to everyone we could find who saw anything. No one contradicts the story that Culp and his pals have been tormenting Pavelka for months, and everyone agrees that Pavelka is quiet and keeps to himself. Anything else?
Nate thumbed a couple of pages in his notebook.
Pavelka has a girlfriend named Splinda Turner. She's his only frequent visitor that I can tell. Got an address on her? No. Track her down and see what you can find on Reese Perkins.
As Nate strode away, Pete withdrew his phone and keyed in the number for another one of his officers. When the call picked up, he said,
Seth, meet me at the station in 10 minutes.
3. Zoe was relieved to see Dr. Charles Davis and his merry band of followers had moved on by the time Earl backed Medic 2 into its bay. She didn't have the energy to deal with him on a good day, but especially not this afternoon. Earl cut the engine.
I hope no one ate my lunch.
Lunch? Zoe had forgotten about it. I'm not hungry. Earl was halfway out of the ambulance but stopped and looked at her as if she'd sprouted another head.
You? Not hungry? Maybe I need to run you to Brunswick Hospital for a complete checkup.
She made a face. Ha ha. He chuckled as he climbed the rest of the way out and slammed the door. Zoe slid down from the passenger side and followed him into the office. Tony sat at the desk.
Zoe? He jerked a thumb over his shoulder. You have a visitor.
A woman beamed at her from the bench next to the large front window. Zoe stared. Lauren? The reporter stood and extended her hand. I thought you might have spotted me earlier. Other than sporting a shorter, edgier haircut, she hadn't changed much since Zoe had last seen her. She grasped Lauren's hand. I did, but wasn't sure it was you. What are you doing here? Reporting. Lauren glanced over Zoe's shoulder at the two men. I know you're on duty, but is there some place we can talk? Tony's chair creaked as he climbed to his feet.
I can take a hint.
He slapped Earl on the back.
Come on, we're missing the pit game anyway.
They headed toward the door to the crew lounge. Tony paused and called to Zoe.
Your lunch is in the fridge.
Once they were alone, Lauren made a shooing motion. I'll go get your food. I'll talk while you eat. I'm not really hungry. Lauren shot her a look. One thing I know about EMS is you eat when you get the chance. You might be on runs for the next 12 hours.
You have a point. 2 minutes later, they perched on opposite ends of the vinyl-covered bench with Zoe's BLT from Walden's between them. What happened to the newspaper job you'd taken in Detroit? Zoe asked. Lauren slung an arm over the back of the bench and made a face. The press went out of business. Besides, I liked it here, and Marcus was homesick. The troubled teen Lauren was fostering. How's he doing? Better. To be honest, I'd have left Detroit even if the job still existed. The city wasn't a good fit. Marcus was getting mixed up with a bad crowd. Moving back, Lauren picked at a piece of lint on her dark gray slacks. Well, I thought Pete might be able to adjust his attitude again. Zoe took a bite of her BLT and chewed, letting her mind wander to last winter and the fights Marcus had gotten into, as well as the contentious beginning to her relationship with Lauren. At one time, Zoe had pegged the reporter as willing to do anything for a story. She'd been wrong. Speaking of Pete, Lauren said, I understand congratulations are in order. Thanks. Zoe resisted the almost involuntary reflex to flash the ring. She suspected Lauren had a thing for Pete at one time and didn't want to flaunt her victory in the competition. By the way, I don't suppose you need any help at your barn, do you? Lauren asked with a hopeful grin. As a matter of fact, my cousin left for Florida this week to spend time with my mother. If you want to come out and help, I'm sure Patsy's offer to ride her horse still stands. That would be great. Time on the farm is exactly what both Marcus and I need. But we can talk about all of that later. The reporter reached into a leather satchel at her feet and came up with a notebook and pen. One of the reasons I'm here is all business. What can you tell me about the call you took earlier? I understand there was a shooting. Zoe swallowed. Why weren't you at the scene? I was busy finishing up with Dr. Davis. Would you rather answer questions about him? She coughed. No. Lauren grinned triumphantly. Then tell me about the shooting. Who did you say you were working for? I didn't. Zoe took another bite. She wouldn't answer Lauren's questions with her mouth full, but Lauren didn't have any excuse. I'm freelancing for the Monongahela edition of the Pittsburgh Reporter. Zoe waited, sensing there was more to the story. I'm hoping if I can prove myself, they'll put me on staff. Picking up a napkin, Zoe wiped mayo from her fingers and mouth. Lauren was back where she'd been last winter, career-wise. Okay, yes, there was a shooting in Langstown. She relayed the facts of the case. Horace Pavelka, Danis Culp, the type of weapon. Lauren huffed as she lowered her pen. Come on, Zoe, I got that much from the police radio and your crew chief's report. Help me out here. I know you're the deputy coroner on scene. Give me something I can really use. You mean a scoop? Lauren's lips slanted into a hint of a grin. A scoop would be good. Zoe debated how much to share. She wouldn't mind offering her thoughts about Horace's current situation or his past to a friend. And she intended to tell Pete all about it. But while Lauren might have grown into a friend over time, at the moment, anything Zoe said was destined for print. Reading Zoe's hesitation, Lauren offered, I don't have to use your name. I can say a source with the county EMS or the coroner's office. Great. Franklin would love that. Like either of those would conceal who spoke with you. Off the record, then? When Zoe shot Lauren a skeptical look, she added, Give me a starting point. I'll have to work to get another source for confirmation, but at least I'll have an idea of what direction to go. Zoe picked up a piece of bacon that had fallen from the sandwich, popped it in her mouth, and used the chance to ponder Lauren's offer. Off the record,
Dennis Culp and his cronies had been bullying Horace for quite a while. Today, Dennis took a baseball bat to Horace's car with Horace inside. So he shot him.
Self-defense?
Yep. But that's not the whole story. I've known Horace since high school. He was always the quiet, sweet kid. Kinda nerdy. He'd never pick a fight or even stand up to anyone else who started one. Zoe hoped Lauren wouldn't pick up on the small lie. Off the record or not, she wasn't prepared to share the rest with anyone. Except Pete. Lauren studied her.
This wasn't the first instance of bullying he's faced.
No, not the second or third or even tenth. He's been picked on and pushed around all his life. I think today he decided he'd had enough.
You mentioned Culp's cronies. What are their names?
Zoe reached the end of her willingness to help.
I'm sure you can find out easily enough. You wanted a place to start. I've given you one.
She picked up what was left of the BLT and took a bite.
Fair enough. The history of bullying makes for a good angle.
Lauren eyed her.
I said today's shooting was one of the reasons I'm here. The other is more personal. For you, anyway.
Oh? Zoe said, around a mouthful of sandwich. Lauren came forward, her gaze unwavering.
I heard about what happened this spring.
Zoe stopped chewing, a chill settling over her.
I think I can find your brother.
Grant and Stanley Jennings shared a double wide on a plot of land surrounded by what used to be their grandparents' farm. The land had been broken up and sold off over the years, leaving the brothers with an acre bordered on one side by a newly remodeled brick house, and on the other side and back by fallow cornfields. The rain had stopped by the time Pete and Officer Seth Metzger pulled into the driveway, occupied by a one-ton dump truck, an empty lowboy trailer, and a battered GMC pickup. Jennings Brothers' construction was stenciled in chip paint on the dump's doors.
I hope I didn't interrupt anything important on your day off, Pete said to Seth, who normally worked the graveyard shift on weeknights.
Seth hesitated just long enough for Pete to know the next words out of his mouth weren't entirely true.
Nope, nothing.
Pete eyed him askance.
You could have brought Abby along, you know. The more the merrier.
Abby was Vance Township's newest officer, Wayne Baronic's kid sister, and the woman who'd claimed Seth's heart. A rush of red singed Seth's neck and crawled into his cheeks.
We're supposed to have dinner later.
You might still make it. Any progress with the task force?
A widespread string of thefts had prompted the Mon County PD to pull together a multi-jurisdictional team in a so far unsuccessful attempt to catch the culprits. Pete had assigned Seth and Abby as Vance Township's representatives.
That's part of our dinner plans, going over the files. I keep thinking we're missing something.
Pete knew that feeling well.
It's a working dinner. Kinda.
He opened the car door.
Remember what they say about all work and no play.
No sidewalk led to the front entrance of the recently re-sided house, so Pete and Seth slushed through the puddles to the rear stoop. Pete pressed the doorbell. He didn't detect chimes or footsteps inside. After a minute, he pounded on the storm door. Stanley Jennings yanked the door open fast enough for Pete to believe the man had been lurking inside, his hand on the knob. Stanley's eyes darted from one cop to the other, settling on Pete.
What do you want?
The glass of the storm door began to fog from the cold outside air.
Is your brother home? Pete asked. Maybe. Why?
We'd like to talk to both of you.
What about?
Pete fixed him with a hard stare through the hazed glass. Even with the nearly obscured view,
A few seconds of Pete's intense gaze was all it took for Stanley to crumble.
Grant, get out here.
Grant appeared at his brother's side. Their family bonds were obvious in their shared, longish, dirty blonde hair, gray eyes, and their thin, hard physiques. Stanley stood a few inches shorter than Grant, a deep scar across his left cheek. Grant opened the storm door but blocked the way in case Pete and Seth intended to enter. He took in the two law enforcement officers as well as their weapons and glared at Pete.
You hear about that scum horse-ass Pavelka gunning down Dennis Culp in cold blood?
Pete winced, wondering if that was a nickname he'd had to put up with all his life.
I understand you both were witnesses.
Damn straight. Saw the whole thing.
Then you won't mind telling us what happened.
Pete didn't pose it as a question.
I told you, Pavelka gunned Dennis down.
In cold blood, yes. Where can we talk?
Grant indicated the room behind him with a nod of his head.
In here?
Stanley turned, but Pete stopped him with a raised hand.
No, Stanley, you stay and talk to Officer Metzger. Grant, you and I will speak inside.
Stanley shot a wide-eyed look at his brother, who glared back at him. Pete could read the unspoken order. Play it cool, as clearly as if Grant had barked it out loud. Stanley gave a quick nod.
Okay.
He grabbed a light jacket from next to the door and brushed past Pete. Once inside, Pete looked around as Grant shoved the door closed behind him.
I ain't paying to heat the outside.
Pete knew Seth's body armor and winter coat would keep his officer sufficiently warm. He wasn't so sure about Stanley's jacket. Grant led the way from a surprisingly neat kitchen to a living room decorated with varying shades of brown and beige. Mismatched frames on a shelf held photos, including one of the brothers, arms draped around each other's shoulders, the dump truck behind them. Another was an older photo of what appeared to be prior generations of the Jennings family. There were a couple of Grant and Stanley standing in front of what Pete guessed were their building projects. One photo showed Stanley cheek to cheek with a cute strawberry blonde who seemed blissfully unaware that she could do much better. And in another, three men, Stanley, Grant, and Dennis Culp, knelt with a trio of antlered bucks they'd bagged.
What do you want to know? Grant asked.
Pete picked up the hunting photo and turned it toward Grant.
What were the three of you doing in Langstown?
What difference does it make? Last I checked, it's still a free country.
Pete set down the photo.
You're going to make this difficult, are you?
No.
Grant folded his arms across his broad chest.
Just don't see why it's police business what we was doing. Now what we seen, that's police business.
All right. Tell me about what you saw.
Horse ass shot Dennis Culp. Killed him in cold blood.
Where was Horace when this happened?
In his car. He tried to run us over.
Where were you when this happened?
On the sidewalk.
And he drove onto the sidewalk?
Grant's eyes shifted.
Yeah.
Huh, that's odd. There's a stretch of grass between the road and the paved sidewalk on that street. As wet as it's been, there would have been tire tracks. There weren't any.
Are you sure you weren't in his driveway when this happened?
Maybe.
But he tried to run us over.
What did you do when he tried to run you over?
What do you mean?
Did you jump out of the way?
Grant thought that one over.
Yeah, we did.
And then what?
He shot Dennis.
Through his window?
Yeah.
Did he roll the window down first?
Another hesitation.
No, he shot right through it. Busted the glass. You sure it wasn't Dennis who broke the glass? With a baseball bat?
No way.
Then how did Horace's car get smashed up?
I don't know. Maybe he hit a deer on the road or something.
Grant's eyes lit up.
Or maybe he really did run into Dennis. I mean, Stanley and me got out of the way, but...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.